yesterday has come and gone, with us trials far behind. But I'm ever learning, Lord, and every day I find
I need you more today than I did yesterday. Mountains are higher, rivers are wider. I need you more today than I did yesterday. Help me remember, I need you more today.
Help me remember,
I need
to check on my mama on the way to church to see how she was doing. Today was a pretty aggressive day for her prep. But you know, she's really in good spirits and she's handling it and she's counting down the days. And you know, why should we worry when we have faith in Jesus? And so that's kind of where she is. She said she's not worried. You know, we're going to take it one step at a time. So y'all just remember her on Tuesday. Remember us. Remember Raji, he's not going to be used to not having somebody there to wait on him. So.
About tomorrow and what the future holds.
And above all tonight, pray for the church. We're going to be in the first chapter of Revelation. Lord, just give us a thought to share with you tonight, and that's what we're going to do. Revelation chapter 1. Hopefully, we were talking last night, our technology needs to be technolized. We get this stuff all working up here or do away with it. One, it doesn't matter either way, but we depend on something we expect it to work, right? In Revelation chapter 1, we want to pick the thought up there from John. If you'll notice in the Old Testament, if you read a lot, and I know you do, right? And particularly in the prophets or in the kings, the Lord, there's a phrase that we hear oftentimes, and it says, the word of the Lord came. The word of the Lord came to the prophet, or the word of the Lord came to whoever was doing the speaking and the addressing. Well, one of our major issues today is we don't have men who will stand up and say, I got a word from the Lord. We're getting a lot of word, but oftentimes it's not a word from the Lord. And so we're going to look at that possibility here in Revelation chapter 1. Beginning with verse 1, it says, revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him to show unto his servants things which must shortly come to pass. And he sent and signified it by his angel unto his servant John. You see all that goes on with the Lord when the Lord sends a word. It's something to be taken seriously and to weigh heavily against truth. Because we know that the word of God is all truth. And so tonight is why we talk about that. Think about that. John then, after receiving the word, bear witness. Who bear record of the word of God and of the testimony of Jesus Christ and of all things that he saw. Blessed is he that readeth, and they that hear the words of this prophecy and keep those things which are written therein, for the time is at hand. So we want to talk about that tonight. We want to talk about, Paul and the other disciples, of course, wrote in their books and letters that we have in the New Testament. They wrote about the things which must come, and one of the things which must come is false doctrine. That's one of the worst things in the world that can be in your home, can be in your church, can be anywhere when it comes to the Word of God. To be taught falsely the things that God has spoken to us, or to make someone feel like they can do anything according to the word of God and get by with it. It's one of the most destructive forces that has been leased in the world against the church is false doctrine. We right now in the Southern Baptist Convention, which started last year in Nashville, that we are... They are elected people that are going to do away with the elderly people like me and get some people that are on board for now. And they're going to update who we are. We've been so far behind. Build more churches. And in spite of the fact that we're losing 1,500 every year and they're sitting open somewhere, we're going to build more so they can get rid of the old and put in the new. And that's false. That's where the false doctrine's coming. Y'all have heard me talk about back in the 70s when I got saved and when the Lord called me to preach in 72. And we had seminaries in our Southern Baptist seminaries, preachers that were graduating who did not believe in the virgin birth then. And not just a small number, but a large number of them didn't believe in it. Much more so now, and you know that as well as I do. People don't talk much about what they believe. They tell you to mind your own business. Don't tell me what to put in my body, and don't tell me any of that kind of stuff. I have control over my body. I have control over everything. But you know what? Jesus pointed out very clearly that we must not have control over our mind, because he said, let this mind be in you which was in Christ. And so when you think about that stuff and you start to put it all together, you don't need to look to the fact they defunded the police. You don't need to look to the fact that they got a sorry mayor in Chicago or New York or wherever you want to blame somebody. You need to look at the church. That's where you need to start first. If we can get the church orchestrated and organized around the very idea that the word was sent to the church that's in the world. And we are our conveyors of the word of God, as John picked the word of God up and bear record of it. That's what the scripture says. That means he told the word of God. He went about and he set an order. You can read what he wrote down and what God told him not to write down. He didn't. And so we're living under the darkness of a false doctrine. And because of that, it's in the New Testament, which says we're going to have a falling away. Well, I want to tell you there's been a falling away ever since. From Genesis to now has been a falling away. We've only been downhill since God threw man out into darkness, so to speak, out of the garden and flooded the land. We've been going downhill ever since. God's made a plea for our souls at Calvary with Jesus Christ. We're still going downhill. We have a few faithfuls. We have a remnant that has not been spotted by the world, as the scripture says. But generally speaking, Jesus said there's two ways, the broad and the narrow. And many there be who go in at that broad gate. And so when we think about, and you'll see if you read Revelation, you'll see the result of not believing or trusting in and not going back. And the Bible, when Jesus was getting ready to leave, and those that were with him then were hoping he wouldn't leave. You know that. But they kind of in a begging way told him not to. He says it's expedient. That means it's necessary that I go, and that I go now. It's expedient that I go, and if I go, that I'll send to you a comforter. Y'all remember that discussion? And that comforter, the Spirit, will lead you into all truth and reveal truth to you, and you shall know the truth, and the truth will make you free. That's the Spirit. And so what does the devil set out to do? Paul said in Thessalonica, don't quench the Spirit. And so what did he set out to do? Quench the Spirit. Send you to church with the world and everything else on your mind, so that the Spirit don't have a work in your life during the service. That's quenching the Spirit. And so he set out to do that because the Spirit will reveal all truth and lead us into all truth. So when you think about all that stuff, everything's been set in order. Everything has been told if we would just listen. Now, just because you know people that wrote a book on Revelation does not mean Revelation changed. It means if in their writing, if they changed it, they changed. Because anything God does never changes. You say, preacher, you must, because your version there may not line up. Preacher, you must, what if something's wrong with the version you got? Well, I'll take that chance. I mean, I think it's closer than any other one I know. I can't get over into the museums and get the one they use to interpolate a lot of this stuff out of, but we can get close to it. We can see what it says. But I'm going to take John's word as it relates to Revelation, because it came from God to the angels, to Jesus Christ, the Spirit, for he was in the Spirit on the Lord's day. Y'all remember that? And that was when he received the word of God. What about that Spirit we went back to and we revealed? The church has to be spiritual for it to be the church. Isn't that right, Renee? It has to be. It has to be spiritual, because the natural man cannot comprehend the things of God, therefore the church has to be. And if it's not, then we're not being what we're supposed to be. And therefore, is our problem. You see, he began by revealing the churches. He wrote letters to the churches and to the elders in the church and told them what was going on in the church during that age. For example, the first one Paul wrote letters about, Ephesus left their first love. Now, that's not a good place to start, but that's where it started. The very first age of the church was a age when the church left their love of Christ. You think about that, and you go back and read it. The letter that Paul wrote to that church and about that church, it's just amazing to me. There's no disconnect with James or John or any of the rest of them who were writing the things of God. God cannot be double-tongued. He cannot be double-thoughted. He can't be to you one thing and to me another. He's God or he's not. And so God the Father, the Son, and Holy Ghost with one body, one spirit, one baptism, that's where we stand tonight as a church of the living God. There's no other place to stand. I don't care how big the banner in front of the church or how many people go there. I'm telling you, in the Word is where we got to be. And if you can find a little fellow here that's never didn't graduate from high school, and find a fellow that'll stand up there with leather lungs and preach this book right here, you got the man God wanted you to have. He may not be eloquent in speech. He may say ain't and can't. He may mispronounce some of these old words that are long and hard, but he'll tell you the truth about Jesus and how you are supposed to live when you say you have been born again. And that's what we need to hear over and over and over again until people get upset about it. I mean, people are just saying today, I just don't want nothing to do with that. I'm just, we overworked, overtired, over this and over that, and just not going to do it anymore. Just took a break. We frustrated, overcome by the work, the things we're doing. And that's what we got, honey. And that's where we're going to be until the church, the fire catches on in the church, and the church becomes a spiritual place in the community for the people together that say they're Christ. Amen? And it seems to me like we fight as hard as we can not to be the very thing the Lord wanted us to be. Any of y'all see that? I mean, there's a lot of books we can read, and some of it may help us, some of it may not. But if we hadn't read this book, don't read no other book, because this book will guide you in all truth. If you're reading some other book that's not all truth, you're going to be caught up in a lie. And I don't think people write books to deceive. They just write books because they feel like they've been given an inspiration. But if you need to be careful when you're reading my book, if I write it. You need to be careful when you're reading some other people's book. But I'm going to tell you, be especially careful when you're reading this book. Because it said, if any man add thereto or taketh away from that, I'm telling you, it's taken away from you and those things. And so tonight, as we think about this and we think about what's happening, we think about a declining or a dying church, and we think about the world we live in, and you see what happens is the tendency is that what's happening in my life is someone else's fault. That's our tendency. You know, in effect, the criminals say it's the environment I was brought up in. And some of it may very well be. And so it just goes down the hill. We, dysfunctional families, we've got words like that. See, we don't call it a lost family, we call it dysfunctional. We don't call alcohol a drunk, it's alcoholism. I'm telling y'all, we've renamed sin to make it more suitable for our participation. And if we get caught in it, we won't feel so bad because it won't sound as bad as the King James Version. But the Bible, in a spiritual sense, when God talks about his church, he said they went whoring. You look at the book and you look up the definition of whoring and see what it tells you. It drives home the point of untrustworthy, untruthful in our relationship with the Lord when we go whoring after other gods. And that's in the commandments, thou shalt have no other gods before me. Now, I'm telling you, when you see in big, bold letters where he said that they've gone a-whoring after these other gods, that really makes that thing vulgar when you think about going after these other gods in the word that the Lord used to describe. That's not my word. That's His word. And so when you think about it, and think about the illustration, how God has illustrated it for us, all we need for our teachers is to hold the Bible in their hand and teach the Bible. Amen? Is that what y'all doing? Who is your biggest class and the best class that you could have as a teacher? Your family. Right? No? Who gives a who? Somebody say something. Thank you. But that's it. And that's where we're riding. And so the Lord speaks to John. Everybody's interested in what's going to come to pass. Well, why aren't we interested in what's happening now? Because what's happening now is going to make what comes to pass a reality. Because that's what he's writing about. These are future things that he's writing about. And they're literally have come to pass, many of them, and they're coming to pass, and they will come to pass because the Lord said they would. But the sad part of it is, it doesn't matter how many times we have read the book, we still are not following what the Lord said. So you have somebody like Elijah and the slayer of false prophets who had an appeal to heaven and God rained down fire and destroyed the altars of Baal. And they still didn't believe. They wanted to kill him for killing false prophets. They wanted to destroy. Let me tell you the attitude we have today. I was behind a truck coming to church or somewhere today or yesterday. And on the back window of that truck says, kill all drug dealers in the community. How many of them letters you buy and stick on there? Now, ain't that stupid? As much as you might want to, you might have an addicted brother or sister or mom and daddy. But you don't go out there with a gun and start shooting drug dealers in the community. That's not your deal. Shouldn't be anyway. But I said, probably 18 to 25, and he got one of them ARs hanging on his window back there and makes him look like a hero when he really don't know it makes him a zero. And they end up in the court system. Sometimes they're so much underage, they won't do nothing to them and hide their record. But this is where that stuff comes from. Somebody trying to make a statement. Then the kind of boys or the whoever boys. It used to be the goat gang of Tabor City or the Beaver Dam boys back yonder when I was a teenager. And everybody, we'd be afraid of us. We're a gang of goats. I mean, I said, well, I got some of them. Smell pretty bad. But that's what they called themselves. Goat gangs. They got whipped a few times, and they decided we better break this thing up because they're going to kill us if we keep running around here. And when you stop and think about it, there's never been a time in history. Are y'all listening? There's never been a time in history when we could more impact the world that we live in than right now. Never been a time. I do wish that somebody would rise up and fill the Washington, D.C. from the monument all down through there full of people who want to see revival instead of somebody pulling for a man and trying to make an impression on other men to get that man voted into office. I do wish that we would load up buses on a regular basis and go up there in front of the Supreme Court building and go up there and in front of the Congress and raise our voice with a loud noise for Jesus Christ. But my God, when you can't get a busload to come to church, how are you going to take 1 million people to Washington? Y'all understand and see what's going on? And that's not going to change because we have had some falling away. And the falling away is beginning to affect. It's like inflation is beginning to affect the cost of living for us. Gasoline has gone up to this. We can talk about that and know exactly how much it costs to buy diesel fuel and how much it costs to buy a gallon of gasoline. I want to tell you something. What would a man give in exchange for his soul? That's the thing we need to be hearing. That's the thing we need to be listening to. What would it cost for throwing the Lord down and the way of the Lord and the things of the Lord and going ahead with your plan? What would it cost you? We used to have a song about that too, which I won't sing. Y'all don't need to hear me sing. What would you give in exchange for your soul? If God called today and we got carried away, what would you give in exchange for your soul? And so John, on being there on the Lord's day, being in the Spirit on the Lord's day, it says in verse 10 that I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day. And that's how I knew no to that. And he says, and heard behind me a great voice as of a trumpet. You see, there won't be no mistaking when God is giving you a word. It'll be like a trumpet in your ears when God is giving you a word, an emphatic word, or it may be in the wind or the storm because you may be going through a storm. But like Elijah, you'll hear the word of God. You'll be fed by the instruments of God, and you'll become the person of God that he's intended for you to be if you listen. But there's no listening. I thought about it yesterday, and I didn't watch a lot of football yesterday because Alabama's my team. But I saw enough to see 100,000 here and 100,000 there, and I didn't hear nobody screaming in the midst of that 100,000. Be saved. But you do see every now and again when the cameras don't catch them, you'll see John 3:16. Somebody's silently putting a sign up down in the end zone, John 3:16, or on the back of their helmet or something, John 3:16. But there's not near as much as that as it used to be. You know the boy that played down in Florida, that was their quarterback. He used to have it on his tennis shoes under his eyes here. He painted it with that black paint under his eyes, Tim Tebow. He had it. That little young fellow that plays out there for that professional basketball team, he used to ride it on his shoes, but I noticed since he went anti-government and anti-flag and all that, he's quit wearing that on his shoes. It's so easy to get in a movement. It's so easy to follow the current movement and crowd. But I want to tell you, it ain't hard to go to hell, just keep on living like you're living. It ain't hard to go to hell, keep on believing like you believe. And you can take that mess off your shoes or put it under your eyes or wherever you want it. You can get tattoos all over your body. But I'm telling you, you'll go to hell if you don't go Jesus' way. I don't care where you're from, who you are, how long you think you've been saved, how many churches you've been a member of. If you're not walking every day in the Spirit of the Lord, you got issues. And you got problems. And something needs to be done about it. And that's what John is going to write. And he's going to give us three chapters of that, and fourth chapter we're going to get called up. In other words, it'll be done. That's the message from the Lord. And for those that are remaining behind, after the rejection of Jesus, after the rejection of the gospel as they rejected the command in the Garden of Eden, there's going to be punishment for that rejection. Y'all understand that? You can almost see it in how we discipline our children. Discipline is not a pretty thing. Did y'all know that? You know what? The Lord, in his discipline, he slew everybody over 20 years old in the wilderness. How many million came out of the bondage in Egypt? He slew every one of them because they did not obey his word. You think that was kind of pretty? I don't think so. I think that was the messiest place you could have been. And the smell in this place and the stench went up. Don't you know it went up? I'll tell you, when that water subsided and Noah found himself in the ark with them animals and stuff, that had perished in the flood, I'm telling you, that was the stinkiest place you could have been. That's what sin does to you. It always has a stink that you can't help. You can't miss its odor. It will always leave you dead. The wages of sin is dead. And so John, oh, crazy John, that's what they called him, you know, the hierarchy. Said, that man's crazy, and they exiled him from the main church, exiled him to an isle called Patmos. And it was there that the Lord said, oh, crazy John, I got something I want you to tell the world. And it just so happens he was in the Spirit on the Lord's Day. I'm going to tell you, that speaks, number one, to the people who don't want to be in the house of God on the Lord's Day, who plan futures not to be in the on the Lord's Day in the house of God. Jesus also said, as the Bible says, as was his custom, he was in the house of prayer. He was in the house of God. I'm telling you, there's so many scriptures, but you can offend so many when you begin to work on them. Just in this small group of people, you should witness it right here. There was people sitting there, and there were people sitting there, and there were other people that didn't come back here tonight. What did they have? Did any of y'all see any of them with sickness this morning? Was anybody throwing up and falling over and sick, looked like they needed to be at the doctor? Then why are they not in church tonight? Will somebody please tell me? Why weren't there a conviction of in their life this very day of where they needed to be? Why? Why are there no conviction in people's life? You know why? If you believed it enough, there'd be some conviction in there. If you search out the history of what God told you and people didn't do it, and the Bible plainly says those things that were written aforetime were written for our learning that we wouldn't do what they did and be punished as they were punished. It's right there in the book. But yet, every day, every week, it makes a longer list of disobedience in church members' lives who promised us and other churches that they would be here to help account for and to build a church, and they're not here. Can I tell you what? It's like these flags represent right here. To me, that's blood. That's commitment. That means surrender all. We got a hymn that we sing during the invitation. I surrender all. To me, that flag represents surrendering all. This other flag we got, the religious flag, represents Christ surrendering in all. But when we hear about the revelation, okay, preach on revelation. I want to hear it, preacher. Why? Why do you want to hear it? There's nothing pleasant in Revelation until you get to 22. Chapter 22, and he says, behold, I come quickly. And he ends the book by saying, come quickly. That's just the way it is. After all the calamity and all the destruction and all that we've gone through for no reason at all, other than the fact that our leaders do not believe what he said and don't teach it and preach it and lead churches to believe that, we are divided. We're divided by color. We're divided by race, nationality. We're divided by everything and call ourselves followers of Christ. Is that wedding music? I hear. So he goes on and begins to describe the one who gave him what he was about to tell us. He describes him many ways, and the way he describes him, it's very easy to recognize it's Christ that's letting him know what's happening. The voice is so loud and so firm that that's the voice. You know, when he comes in 1 Thessalonians, it's with a shout. And a trump of God's going to sound. I'm telling you, he's not going to step out on the corridor of eternity and say, okay, y'all, come on. I'm ready now. Y'all just come on now. I don't want to wake nobody up and scare you. Come on. You think that's the way it's going to be? You're talking about a racket. Russia will wake up. China will wake up. Communist nations will wake up. And Baptist churches will wake up. Can I tell you that? Amen? I'm not anything but a Baptist, but I know how Baptists are. They're the biggest bunch of hypocrites in the whole world. Everywhere I've ever been, there's no sincerity in what they say and who they profess to be. The ones that carried my suitcase in were the ones who carried it out in just a little short while. You start preaching the gospel and preaching the truth, they'll invite you to leave. But as long as you're eloquent in speech and dress the way you ought to dress and do that stuff. Got the wife that plays the piano and three or four youngins. You can be their pastor, but don't you dare preach about our sin. Don't you dare say nothing about my drinking alcohol, sipping wine, and carrying on with that mess. Woe to the man who does such stuff as that. But yet we do it anyway. You know, I've heard people criticize Donald Trump over and over and over again. He said he never put that stuff on his mouth. He didn't profess to be no Christian. He said he never did it. But you criticize him because he's on some posting Facebook thing or something all the time. I'll tell you right now, we hold the wrong things in value. And John's out there telling us, listen to what he says. I'm just going to go over some of these. And he said he turned when that voice spoke, and he turned to them when he wanted to listen. And then he's beginning to take the letters to the churches. And like I said, the first one was Ephesus. Is that lit? It says, because you left your first love. The second one, and this is in chapter 2, if you want to look there, and he says, I have more against you. And then look at it, and the second one, he says, you've followed the doctrine of the Nicolaitans. That was one of the groups that were going wrong, and you know, and then on and on, he goes down the list. Unto the angel at Smyrna, right? He's on. I don't know why people want to name their church Smyrna. Because there in the Bible is the Lord telling them, I know what you've been doing. I know your works and where thou dwellest, is what he says about them. And he goes on down through all that, and he gets to Laodicea in chapter 3. Now, Laodicea catches a lot of flack, but let me tell you something, rightly so. Because they weren't nothing to Laodicea. They were hot, they weren't hot, and they weren't cold. They would go along with anything and anybody. They had no firm convictions about nothing. And many people have taken a pen to paper, and have artists have taken whatever they use and brushed to canvas and painted pictures of the Lord standing at the door of the church at Laodicea, trying to put it in focus so that we could see exactly how terrible a thing that was. But he's standing out there, and whoever the artist was very smart, because there's no door handle on that church. That door can represent the church or heart. But whichever one it represents, nobody recognized Jesus. I think it's time to do more than write letters when churches don't know who Jesus is. Because they didn't. They didn't know who it was. And he plainly told them while he was standing there, and I didn't see nobody come or read in the scripture where nobody came and let him in. In fact, it's just the opposite. When Peter and them were locked up in Jerusalem after they came down and preached the great messages from the upper room experience, when they were locked up and the church went on over there to pray, and Peter came walking out there and the little maiden came out to see him, it scared her to death. Here they are in there praying for this man to get out and to come to them, and there he is. He comes to them, and they don't believe or receive him for a while there. That's exactly what it's all about. Can I tell you something? You can always lean on the Word of God. You won't never have a flat tire with it. You won't never run out of gas. It is forever and ever and ever. The Bible says whatever the Lord has placed his hand to and put his hand on will be forever. He's an eternal God, and everything he does has to be eternal. He heals you, you're healed. Look, you don't keep looking for something to come back. You're healed. If the Lord heals you, you're healed. Whom the Lord has made free, your free indeed. Amen? And that kind of stuff. And so if he gives you a word, Steph, you got a word. Don't provoke him with false doctrine. And so we get that flighty picture there of Laodicea, and they're not going to listen, haven't been listening. And I remember years ago, I know y'all seen that movie Billy Graham, Left Behind. Y'all ever seen that? And it shows the focus in that movie is pretty good-sized church with a lot of members who had a liberal preacher. I mean, for you Baptists here tonight, you would have believed him too. He was so convincing. But when the rapture came, him and that whole crowd of people were lifted. They were left behind. And they looked at him and they turned to him and they began to inquire. Why didn't they inquire before the Lord come? Why did they get so comfortable? Why are you so comfortable? You ought to be stirred up about people living in disobedience. You ought to be stirred up by leadership who's unfaithful. You need to be stirred up about these issues because, folks, we are not stirred up anymore. We don't have roll call in our churches. We say, oh, that's outdated. Why was that outdated when we required people to stand before the church and explain why they didn't come to church? Why was that outdated? It's outdated because we are more sophisticated, isn't that right? Yes, we are. You might as well go ahead and say it. I'm not going to go to these backwood churches who still have judgment in the church from the Word of God. I'm not going to go listen anymore when all the people talk about is sin. Better read the New Testament, you reckon? It talks about sin more than it talks about heaven. Don't you reckon we might need to go back to Revelation and see why God judged the churches? Why he's going to pour out such wrath and indignation on the earth? Because don't you think we need to take a closer look? Don't you think we need to look and see why they didn't recognize Jesus as Savior, who came to seek and to save the lost? Wonder why they didn't know his voice when he was calling from the door of the church. Let me in and I will sup with you and you with me. What's happened to church? Church has gone to the dogs. That's what's happening. We're having a form of God, but no power. We're having a form of truth, but there's no truth in what we're doing. I know some lessons are hard to learn. In my lifetime, Blake, when I was growing up, when I was a young 18 to 20-year-old person, I had to learn some hard lessons. I had to learn that alcohol wasn't a good way to go. I had to learn that life weren't about sex. I had to learn that my mama was still the parent I had and respected, and when she gave me a reprimand, I took it. When she died, her reprimand meant more to me than anything in this world other than God himself. You know why? Because she was a godly woman. She was a pearl of Proverbs. And that's what happens. We're too busy with everything now. We'll travel 200 or 300 miles to a ball stadium somewhere and won't travel a mile and a half from the house to go to church. We'll sit in a cold, rainy, open-air ball stadium and won't come to church in a warm car. Pull up under a shelter that's been built to keep you from getting wet, to a heater that's been working all day to keep you warm. I want you to tell me, is anything wrong with the church or not? I think a wise person would very immediately say, amen. This old man must have been a pretty wise and sturdy type fellow in the Lord. I'd have been scared to death from here on. As he begins to see all these things and he's receiving it from the Lord, I'd be scared to death. I don't like to preach Revelation. I don't like to preach it because it ends up before the rapture with a church that doesn't know God. That's heartbreaking. I tell you, that's a tough way to leave here because that stuff over there, that great tribulation stuff, it's not for the weak-hearted because it's coming. Did y'all know that what's going on at our borders? I heard a long explanation yesterday of the millions and now getting up close to the billions of dollars that are made from drug drug dealers, cartels, and these young girls like Addison and Kayla being sold as sex slaves, being used by whatever, perverts or whatever, never to be set free. If they complain, they take them and take them out to an ant bed and strap them over an ant bed. Beat them unmercifully. But where is our president and vice president? Where is the judiciary? Where is our Congress? But more importantly, where is our church? There used to be a day we could influence it, but now they tell us what to do. There used to be a day when we were citizens who were responsible and thought through the Word of God instead of thinking through, what would I do? We don't care what you would do. What I care about is what the Lord says do. I want to tell y'all something. The only time he ever mentioned the government of his day, he said, give to Caesar what Caesar's, and he never mentioned government again. Do y'all understand that? Do you understand it's not our job to go out there and select a leader? He said, whoever's in authority, they're there because I allowed it. I can show you that. We'll have a discussion about it if you want to. I gave them the authority they have. You pray for them. You know as well as I know. I know for me, I can't pray for some of them people. It's hard. But he says you pray for them. And if I did pray, I'd have to bite my tongue because it wouldn't be a truthful prayer. But he says pray for them, for they are your security in your environment. Keep you from being destroyed by some group of animals. But that don't matter if he didn't say it. We say we know he felt that way. He ain't felt no way whatsoever. He could have called 10,000 angels and wiped that whole government out. He weren't worried about no government. Do y'all realize he's the King of Kings and Lord of Lords? Do you know that the Lord has made a footstool of the enemies? Every one of them is a footstool of Jesus. And here we are fretting about what's going to happen in America. I'm going to tell you what's going to happen. 200 million men that marched through that dried up valley over there in Israel to destroy Israel. And I'm telling you, are going to be killed in their Chinese army soldiers. You can worry about China all you want to. God's got their number. Jesus Christ is going to sit on his horse, and he's not going to have a cannon bigger than the world, a bomb that will blow up half the world. Out of his mouth will throw the sword of the Spirit. And through the sword of the Spirit, 200 million soldiers and from one nation will suffer. The blood up to the horse's bridle shall flow. Jesus Christ never raises a sword. The sword he uses is the sword that he handed to John on the Isle of Patmos and said, write these things. But you know what? Poor little old Free Will Baptist Church over there, little old Church of God and the little old Baptist Church are fighting each other over who's right. Y'all know that? Yeah, they are. I never forget. I went to a revival one time. If I were to call the man's name as preaching, y'all know it. And when I was sitting there, I went with a friend of mine. He said, let's go down there and hear that preacher. I went over there, and I was his pastor, the guy that invited me. And this man, he spent his whole sermon preaching about people who go to college being preachers. The whole sermon. Went back to, this man asked me, he said, preacher, you want to come tomorrow night? I says, well, not necessarily, I mean. But I said, yeah, I'll go with you. Guess what happened the second night? Same thing. There's a man still living in this part of the country. He's old and uneducated and retarded. I saw him in town the next day after that second night. And he hollered all down to, hey, preacher wee boy. Me won't talk to you. That's exactly what he said. And I turned around almost embarrassed. He said, me need talk to you. I said, okay, I'll wait for you. Come on. He says, I want to apologize to you for what that pastor said in the pulpit last night. I know you've been to college. I know you're educated. He says, I'm sorry you had to hear that. The only person in the whole revival church was the most ignorant man, according to men, who found me and apologized to me for the ignorance of that man that said God called him. You see, that's why we're fighting among ourselves. Don't trust one another. Can't get the job done because we're not relying on Blake and counting on Jesus. Huh? So that's what happens. I just want you to know how important it is. Here's what we get angry about. When I got out of the car a while ago, y'all kind of watched it, and please forgive me. My Bible fell out of the car. I was helping color and tore all to pieces. And if I were to throw that down there, some of y'all be in flame. You think I disrespected the Bible? I have not disrespected. I used to throw it down and walk on it because I stand on the Word of God. I do not disrespect one iota of the Word of God. Disrespecting the Word of God is being so stupid you don't believe it and obey it. That's disrespect. Oh, I can buy a new Bible, Scofield Bible, tomorrow. That is just a book that the Word of God's contained in. I got more at the house if I needed it. I didn't want it to tear, don't want it to tear now. But let me tell you something. That's not how you disrespect it. High esteem is where I hold that Word of God. In a high place. I thought about that as it fell out on the asphalt over there side of the car near the bus. I says, if some people are watching that, they'd be mad as fire that I let the Word of God get tarnished. I tell you, you know what tarnishes the Word of God? Us, by the way we live. That's what tarnishes the Word of God. I'm going to tell y'all something. We need to be wise about this stuff. I'm going to go home and get me some glue. I'll put some of that ape glue on it. I guarantee you, you'll pull the ape off before you pull the glue. Amen? But that's it. And that's because we cherish it that way. That's why we can't get nothing done. Amen? Jenny, what do you think, honey? When you think about all this stuff. When you see all that's coming to pass. Let me tell you something, and I'm not trying to glorify nobody. I just happen to love Jenny. Jenny is a widow woman. She's 80 plus years old. And I'm sorry, I didn't mean to tell them that. But she is known in our community as a great prayer warrior. She's gone through all kind of health setbacks, cancer and all that kind of stuff, arthritis, all them other arthritis brothers. She's been through all that. She has living in her home, I guess he'd be your nephew, wouldn't it? Nephew. She takes care of him. She did work some down at what's the name of that store? City Trends. She worked. But let me tell you about her. She goes around and people that they're sick or somebody she knows, she gets some chicken and cooks them some fried chicken and takes it to them. She don't have the money hardly herself to eat it. Let me tell you though, but she's doing it all over town for people. Praying for people. That's putting feet to our mission, to our faith. Where's your faith? What are we doing for Jesus? That's the whole thing. We talk about it all the time, Blake. But, son, getting out there and getting in that cabin and loading them logs, that's where it's at. Getting in that thing and cutting them down, whatever you call that, cutter. That's a logger. Logger don't go sit in the truck with a clean pair of britches on and say, I'm a logger. Amen? That's right. You come home every night and your mom won't hardly let you in the door. You're so nasty. That's a logger. You've been in the log woods. You've been logging, right? And that's what that's all about. We've got to get our hands dirty with people we consider dirty. And that's mission work, Sherry. We've got to put our hands back into the mission bowl and help the people that need help. Because we're going to come to this day, Donna, where it'll be done. and the church will be unprepared. It's coming to that day, Brother Doug. I know you and I are wearing out, but I want to tell you something. God still got a place to use us, William. He spared you for a great cause. What is it? Took you through a great trial and a great test, see if you could pass it. You did. Now what? And when you think about all that stuff, you think about what God's doing. Folks, we got seating capacity for 336 people in this church. I remember we had to argue with the old gentleman in Tabor City here that at that time was a building inspector. And if we'd have had just a few more, we'd have had to put part of this sprinkling and all that stuff in. We did everything we could to keep from spending that extra $20,000, and we didn't have to, thank the Lord. But we got seating for 300, and I've never seen this church that many people here to worship. I've seen them here for a funeral, seen them here for a wedding. They'd be lined up in the hallways down here and up there for weddings and for funerals. Never seen it that many people here for that. And I'll be honest with you, we won't never have that many people here for church. Did y'all know that? Did you know that? Because I'm going to tell you, throughout our Southern Baptist Convention, the huge percentage of churches is the size of New Horizon Church. Who pay the bills for the convention? Who do the work? Just don't have the big name preachers that they have in others. You see, we have gone so wrong. I remember several years ago, we had a young man here in Columbus Association, and he came out of South Carolina, and he got active at the church down there at Bolden Church, and he just did everything he could serve the Lord. And eventually, they were so hard on him, they ran him off. They ran him off by not supporting him, not praying for him. A couple years ago, he was the president of the Southern Baptist Convention in North Carolina. He grew from that little 15-member church down there at Bolden to that many thousand in the church he pastored. He's still pastoring the church. He was the president for 2 years. Say, preacher, why are you telling us that? And I'm just telling you right now, if you'll work, God will elevate you to do more work. But if you won't, don't look for that and nothing happens. That's what's going to happen to the church. We're going to keep building contemporary churches till we have a church that doesn't believe in Christ. I know some of you loved contemporary, but keep on loving it. Tom Ward don't love it. I don't find nothing about it in scriptures of all this stuff that they're trying to get churches to do now. Therefore, that's why it's going to fail. So we're up against it from within. We're up against it from without. We've got to work. If we don't push Jesus and talk about him and who he is, as John did, and you can read there, and he'll tell you who he saw and what he looked like. He gives a description to every church of Jesus, some description that they could remember who the messenger is. Now, if you don't believe that, that's right here. Read it. Talked about his feet, his hair, talked out about everything about him. But most of all, he said, it was on this day that he sent the message to me from God through Jesus, through the angels, the servants, to John. That I would leave that mark so that men would know what God feels about the way things are happening. Sensitive. Harden not your hearts as they did in the provocation. And how many died in a few days there, it tells you. That's what's going to happen. I think COVID is a plague. I think it's a designed plague. And God's finding out how strong his church is, and he's found out not very strong. The government told us to shut down, and most of them did. North Carolina governor told us to shut down until we said we'll sue you. He said, you backed off and relented. Said, go ahead. Go ahead with your meetings. California governor wouldn't back off. And all, a lot of the Michigan governor and all these other people. I'm telling you, the church relented from the message of God. And they have been isolated now. And they're going to be destroyed, William, if we don't do something. So every time y'all hear a mission call, a call to revival, we need to have a revival again, don't y'all think? Just a 2 or 3 days. Brother Randy did a great job of preaching, but we need the spiritual thing to break out. Not that he weren't telling the truth and spiritual in his preaching. We need the thing to break open. And where people get so happy, even you arthritis will let go. Huh? That's right. You let go and then just let go and let God. That's what we need. And you know how we're going to get there? Believe that word. Jesus said, and I'm going to close, 70, are you about ready? Jesus said, they'll know you're my disciples if you keep my commandments. Didn't he say that? That's exactly what he said. And if the world sees a church, or a church, another church sees a church who doesn't keep the commandments of the Lord, what do we think about it? That's it. That's it. What do you think about it? How many of y'all have veterans in your home, in your family? In the family, past or present. I know who has them presently. How often do you think about a veteran? Unless you happen to watch the news or something and they throwing down about a veteran, how often do you think about a veteran? They sent our vice president over there to lay a wreath somewhere in some foreign country where our soldiers were buried. She ought to be ashamed to go the way she treats America. But you know what? Their blood was shed for her too. Jesus Christ died for our sins. Undeserving, but he shed it anyway. I thank the Lord for every veteran that I know and don't know. Go out to the Arlington Cemetery out there. They're buried 6 deep, some 7, 6 and 7 people deep to get the people in there. The unknown soldier's 100th year and celebrating the unknown soldier's grave. The ones that they couldn't get a name that they don't remember. The little boy was talking to his father in this church that they were visiting this Sunday, and there was a... In their church, they had a, when you entered the vestibule, they had pictures hanging all around the vestibule. And the little boy said, Daddy, who are these people? And he said, they're the ones that died in service. The little boy thought on that for a minute and said, which one? This morning or last night? Truth of it is, we don't know all those things that people are doing and the reward they're going to receive. And I can prove that with Scripture, and I'm through, Stephanie. Come on up here. For Jesus said unto them, depart from me, I don't know you. That generated surprise, but here's the one I wanted you to hear. But he said unto another, you saw me hungry, and you fed me. You saw me naked, and you clothed me. I was in prison, and you visited me. Lord, when did all that happen? He said, if you do it to the least of these, my children, telling you, witness is coming. You do it also to me. Do it to the least of these, my children. You do it also to me. I'm going to tell you how we are in Tabor City. Where are you at? Okay. What you singing tonight? Forgive me. How we are in Tabor City. Miss Jenny and I, and sometimes... What was that other girl's name that got healed from cancer? Debbie. We'd be up there at the library in Tabor City on the fourth Saturday morning or the one Saturday morning of the month. I think it was the fourth one or the first one or what. Last Saturday, right. And we'd be gathered around a flower pot there and praying. And you could hear people stopping and passing by because we prayed out loud. But we'd stand there and pray for a right good while. We prayed that the Tabor City would change. You wives, quit praying for your husband become like they used to be. Pray that they'll become like God wants them to be, and vice versa. Don't pray for Tabor City to revert back to the days that I remember, because on Friday and Saturday night, it was dangerous to walk the streets. Somebody would be cutting and fighting, and that was out of the way. That was called Razor City. They'd have to clean the bloods up the next day off the street because so many people were getting cut and killed and beat up, not killed, but getting beat up. I'm telling you, the police had a job to do. I don't want to reclaim that. Can I tell y'all that? What I want to reclaim are those churches. I remember Mr. Johnson. People were talking about Mr. Johnson. He was the pastor of the Baptist church in Tabor City, and they said he preached under the anointing of the Holy Ghost. That's what we need to reclaim. We need to reclaim the power of the Holy Ghost in the church. Blind and crippled people being saved. I just want y'all to know and healed. That's what we need back in the church. It's not a joke. It's real. Please forgive us as we sing. Stephanie's going to sing. You come if you will. And God will bless you. See you.